तरी मी त्यांना एकदा परत रिंग करते. अरे सुरू झालंय लगेच लाईव्ह केलंय. ठीक आहे आपण सुरू करूयात. अजून स्पीकर जॉईन व्हायचे तर आपण तोपर्यंत धन्वंतरी स्तवन घेऊया. स्पीकर पण नाही आलेले.
शङ्खं चक्रं जलौकां दधतमृतं घटं चारुदौर्भिश्चतुर्भिः सूक्ष्मं स्वच्छातिरुद्यं शुकपरिविलसनम् मौलिमम्बोज्जनेत्रं कालाम्बोद्योज्ज्वलाङ्गं कटितटविलसश्च चारुपीताम्बराढ्यं वन्दे धन्वन्तरिं तव निखिलगदमिव प्रौढदावाग्निलीलं प्रौढदावाग्निलीलं.
एक वाट बघूया आपण एक 2-3 मिनिट 5 मिनिट ऍटलीस्ट. स्पीकर मॅडम पण नाही आले.
माझं त्यांच्याशी बोलणं झालं 1-5-10 मिनिटं.
कुलकर्णी सरांशी का?
नाही मॅडम त्यांचं आपण रिशेड्यूल झालंय त्यांचं.
हा चालेल चालेल. विमल सर नमस्कार.
नमस्ते मॅडम. नमस्ते.
हा एक 2 मिनिटात सुरू करूया. स्पीकर मॅडम पण नाही आल्या दोन्ही.
हो चालेल मॅडम चालेल काय प्रॉब्लेम.
नमस्कार सर.
नमस्ते. नमस्ते सर.
मॅडम आपला 5वा वेबिनार आहे ना या सिरीज मधला.
हा 5वा आहे.
दुर्गे स्मृता हरसी भीतिं अशेष जन्तो हो स्वस्थये स्मृता मतिमतीव शुभान् ददासि दारिद्र दुख भय हारिणिका त्वदन्या सर्वोपकार करणाय सदार्द्र चित्ता सर्वमंगल मांगल्ये शिवे सर्वार्थ साधिके शरण्ये त्र्यंबके गौरी नारायणी नमोस्तुते।
शङ्खं चक्रं जलौका दधतमृतखडं चारुदोर्भिश्चतुर्भिः सूक्ष्म स्वच्छानुहृद्यां शुकपरिविलसन् मौलिमं भोजनेत्रं कडितडविलसं चारुपीताम्बराढ्यं वन्दे धन्वन्तरिं तं निखिलगदवनप्रौढिदावाग्निलीलं
नमस्कार, गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन। आज के इस इंटरनेशनल वेबिनार में आप सभी का स्वागत है। इस वेबिनार का आयोजन आज दर्पण फाउंडेशन द्वारा किया गया है। आजादी के अमृत महोत्सव के अंतर्गत नेशनल आयुर्वेदा डे के अवसर पर इस खास अष्टांग आयुर्वेद सीरीज को हमने ऑर्गेनाइज किया है। आप सभी वक्तों का या आप जो भी सारे उपस्थित वैद्य है उन सभी वैद्यों का मैं आयुष दर्पण फाउंडेशन की तरफ से बहुत बहुत स्वागत करती हूँ। आप सभी का यहाँ पर बहुत बहुत स्वागत है। और इस सत्र में जुड़े हमारे आज के स्पीकर है डॉक्टर वर्षा सक्सेना मैडम, डॉक्टर पाटिल सर एवं आज के मॉडरेटर डॉक्टर नितिन धनोकार सर। हमारे आज के इस सत्र के चेयरमैन है डॉक्टर आशुतोष कुलकर्णी सर एवं को चेयरमैन है डॉक्टर तुकाराम दुधमल सर। सभी यहाँ पर जो भी मौजूद है वैद्य उन सभी का मैं स्वागत करती हूँ। आज ये हमारा पांचवा सत्र है और इस आयुर्वेद डे के अवसर पर हमने विविध सारे प्रतियोगिताओं का भी आयोजन किया है। आप जरूर आपके जो भी सारे स्टूडेंट्स हैं एवं वैद्य हैं इनके पास ये सभी सर्कुलेट कीजिएगा जरूर, और इस एक खास प्रसंग का आप बिल्कुल हमारे साथ जुड़िए। इस प्रसंग में आप सभी को आमंत्रित करती हूँ मैं, और आज का हमारा ये सत्र जो है मॉडरेट करेंगे वैद्य नितिन धनोकार सर, जो की अकोला से है और प्रोफेसर है शारी रचना डिपार्टमेंट के। तो सर आपको यहाँ पर मैं आमंत्रित करती हूँ, आप प्रोसीड कर सकते हैं, अनम्यूट कीजिए सर, अनम्यूट अनम्यूट।
वेलकम ऑनरेबल चेयरपर्सन, को चेयरपर्सन, स्पीकर्स और ऑर्गेनाइजिंग टीम, ऑल द फैकल्टीज, स्टूडेंट्स for this international webinar series on Ashtanga Ayurveda, which is organized by Ayush Darpan Foundation, Dehradun. As Dr. Shilpa Madam told, it is the fifth webinar of this series, which is based on Shalya Tantra. As we all know that Shalya Tantra is the important branch of Ashtanga Ayurveda, which deals with surgical as well as parasurgical procedures like leech therapy, Agni Karma Chikitsa, Kshar Karma, Char Sutra and many more. Lots of research work is going by experts from all over India in this field, and such webinars are the platform for propagation of their work, which will motivate the new generation. And I think this is the motto of Ayush Darpan Foundation for organizing such webinars. So with the permission of Honorable Chairperson, with the Ashutosh Kulkarni sir, let's start our first session. The topic of the first session, that is management of prolapse rectum by encircling anal canal by Kshar Sutra, that is X therapy. And the speaker is Dr. Varsha Saxena Madam. She is presently working as associate professor, assistant professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, Uttarakhand Ayurved University, Dehradun. She has completed her graduation and MS in Shalya from Rishikul State Ayurved College, Haridwar. She pursued her PhD Shalya Tantra from Banaras Hindu University. She is also expert in yoga. She is having a clinical experience of 10 years and teaching experience more than 7 years. She is performing general as well as anorectal surgeries and also expert in parasurgical procedures like leech therapy, Agni Karma. She has published 5 books and more than 50 research articles are published in national and international journals. She has been recently awarded by Rishikul Bhushan Award in 2019. She is awarded as Junior Research Fellowship by UGC from 2011 to 2014. She has been awarded by Silver Medal and Bronze Medal for her academic performance. She has presented many research papers in various national and international seminars, conferences, and workshops. She is editor for International Journal of Ayush in the discipline of Shalya Tantra. She is associate editor for International Journal of Applied Research. She is a lifetime member of Vishwa Ayurved Parishad. I invite Dr. Varshara Saxena Madam for the presentation.
Thank you, Nitin sir. Let me share my screen. Sir, is my slide visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon to all of you, respected Chairperson, Professor Ashutosh Kulkarni sir, respected co-chairperson Dudhman sir, moderator Professor Nitin sir, Shilpa madam, Naveen Joshi sir, and Arvind sir. Namaskar to all of you. First of all, I would like to extend my great thanks to organizers of this platform who have invited me on this platform for presenting my topic today. Thank you very much, madam. Now, today I'm going to present a very interesting topic of prolapse rectum that has to be treated by Chhasud. And the topic is management of prolapse rectum by ICHS therapy. ICHS therapy is actually, as it is a mnemonic slide. So people are confusing by ICHS therapy. ICHS is E stand for encirclement, A stand for anal, C stand for canal, K stand for char, and S stand for sutra. So encirclement of anal canal by char sutra. It is the whole topic that I'm going to discuss today. If you can't explain it simply, you can't explain well. Someone has said it very well. किसी ने कहा है कि अगर आप किसी चीज को बहुत सिंपल तरीके से नहीं बता सकते तो आप उसको बहुत अच्छे से नहीं समझा सकते. So today I'm going to define my topic in very simple form so that all can understand it clearly. Prior going to the exact topic of ICHS therapy, I would like to share some surgical anatomy, a little bit anatomy of rectum and its physiology, because it is required while doing the procedure. Surgical anatomy of rectum, as all of you know that rectum is almost 5 inches long or 13 centimeter long, and it lies somewhere between the sigmoid colon above and anal canal below. So it begins from the third sacral vertebra in the continuation of sigmoid colon, and it follows the curve of sacrum and coccyx and becomes a continuation with the anal canal. And also the most important part of this, that as all know that rectum is a part of large intestine, but the prominent feature, or you can say the cardinal feature of large intestine, that is secretions, apoplexy and tinea, these are absent in this. And also the rectosigmoid junction is 15 centimeter from anal verge. And the dilated part of the rectum, the lower part, that is called as rectal ampulla. And now here we will talk about somewhat by anorectal angle. So what is this anorectal angle? Pubis, the one of the muscle there is, that is levator ani muscle, and a portion of it is puborectalis. So the puborectalis portion forms a sling with a junction of the rectum with anal canal. And what it do, it pulls this part of the ball forward and produces an angle that is called as anorectal angle. So this angle is important for maintaining the continence of the this particular region. So this is very important, and usually this angle is between 80 to 90 degrees. Now peritoneum, is the covering that covers the rectum, but there is a difference between peritoneum of covering whole of the rectum. So it has been divided into three parts: upper one third, middle one third, and the lower one third. Upper one third of the rectum, that is covered by the peritoneum only anteriorly and the lateral surfaces, while the middle one is covered by only the peritoneum on the anterior surface, and the last lower third is devoid of the peritoneum. And one thing, that is the muscle coat, that is there are the two muscle coat, that is longitudinal and the circular muscle. Outer one is longitudinal and inner one is the circular smooth layer, right? And then mucous membrane, we talk about that together with the circular muscle, they can form the 2 to 3 semicircular component folds or the transverse fold of the rectum. These are the relations, which the organs that are in relation to rectum, difference between the male and female. Again, the difference is only mostly in the anterior part. Like in males, the anteriorly rectum is in relation with bladder, seminal vesicles, ureters, prostate, and urethra. While in case of females, it is in relation with pouch of Douglas, uterus, cervix, and posterior vaginal wall. Now coming to lateral part, it is common in both male and female, that is lateral ligaments are present, middle rectal artery is present, obturator internal muscle is present, side wall of pelvis is present, pelvic autonomous plexus and levator ani muscles. Posteriorly, we talk about the relation of rectum, that is sacrum and coccyx in both the male and female, loose areolar tissue, facial condensation, superior rectal artery, hypogastric nerves, and the left pelvis. These are the relations in which we can differentiate between the male and female, the relations to the rectum. Now, covering the short, the blood and the nerve supply, superior, middle and inferior rectal arteries are that supplies the rectum. So, superior artery that is present, that is in direct continuation with inferior mesenteric artery and is the chief artery that supplies the mucous membrane. After entering into the pelvis, it divides into two branches, that is right branch and the left branch. And then it pierces the muscular cord and supply to the mucous membrane. Now, veins also correspond to the arteries. Superior rectal vein, that is the tributary of the portal circulation, and it drains into the inferior mesenteric vein. Lymph vessels. Excuse me, ma'am. Is my screen share has been stopped?
No, ma'am. No. Blood and nerve supply side is there.
Okay.
Blood
okay.
and nerve supply.
Right. Then, the limb vessels of the rectum, it drains into the pararectal nodes and then into the inferior mesenteric nodes. Right. Then we come to the nerve supply. Nerve supply is also very important, that it is comes from sympathetic and parasympathetic nerves both, and it comes from the inferior hypogastric plexus. Now, covering a little bit of the physiology of rectum. Actually, all these things that incontinence, constipations, all these can limit the patient lifestyle. So just to rule out, we should know a little bit of the anatomy, physiology of the rectum, like this anorectum that is mostly responsible for maintaining the continence and evacuation. And the fetal continence can be maintained by several factors, like both mechanical or neurological. Mechanical factor that is involving into the fecal continence, that is actually the reservoir function of the rectum and also the valve of Huston. It also can slow down the progression of a stool and it can promote a barrier effect. So if we give the mechanical training to the patient, so they can bear down the stool and they can increase the sphincteric tone of their rectum or their anal region. Now this is the pressure which we have to talk about is anal resting pressure. Anal resting pressure, it is maintained by the aid of internal anal sphincter and hemorrhoidal complex. Means these two things are which maintain the anal resting pressure, internal anal sphincter and hemorrhoidal complexes. And now the range of it is usually 40 to 80 mm of Hg, but it is usually higher than the baseline intrarectal pressure. So intrarectal pressure is usually, it do not usually affect it. It only increase during the pregnancy, but it do not increase during the defecation. So it has to be noted down ki what is the intrarectal pressure, what is the resting pressure, what is the squeeze pressure. So the one aid that is investigation, that is anal manometry, which is helpful in measuring all these pressures. Now coming to the reflexes. We will talk about two reflexes over here. Rectoanal inhibitory reflex. What is this? When the feces reaches the rectum with the mass, that is colonic mass, what happens? The rectal wall stretches and it causes the reflexive relaxation of the internal sphincters. Now, while we coming to the defecation reflex, what is this? This is the distension of the rectum that stimulates the contraction of the colon and the rectum. So what they do when the rectum is distended, the rectoanal inhibitory reflex is initiated and the internal anal sphincteric they all what they do, they relaxes, and while the external alveolar sphincters contract and the process of defecation occurs. These are the rectal physiology testing which can be done, because these are the important part in evaluating the patient, those who are having their anorectal dysfunctions like constipations or diarrhea or incontinence. These are like anal manometry, electromyography, nerve stimulation, and sensation measurements. Now coming to a main topic, that is the rectal prolapse. So what is the rectal prolapse? Rectal prolapse is the circumferential descent of the bowel through the anus. That is the bowel that comes out from the anus in circumferential manner is called as rectal prolapse. And it is commonly found in children and adult. Actually, it is found in the extremes of ages, that is present, mostly it is present below the 5 years, commonly below the 3 years, and in the elderly patient more than 40, 50, 60 years of age. It is of two types, that is partial and the complete. Now here we can talk about the partial prolapse and the complete prolapse. So partial prolapse, that is, or incomplete prolapse, it only involves mucous membrane or some mucosa of the partial prolapse. And if it is present like this, in this whole entire thickness of the rectal wall is extruded, then it is complete prolapse. In this picture, we can see this is what? This is an incomplete or partial prolapse, but in this whole of the entire thickness of the rectal wall has come out, then it is the complete one. Now, incidence, we talk about the incidence. It is very common in the pediatric population by the age of 3, as I told you, that is, it is present in the extremes of ages, that adult population after the 5th of decade. Women are more commonly affected, of course, because of repeated childbirth and straining habits, etc. They are most commonly affected in their 5th of the decade and representing 80 to 90% of the patient with rectal prolapse. Men, in case the peak incidence usually declines after the age of 40, but it is not sure that after 40, if men were not found, they can be as their muscles get weakened or laxity of the sphincters occur, it can occur even after 40. Now, but in case of females, the maximum incidence is found in 17th of the 7th decade. प्रवाहन अति साराभ्याम निर्गच्छति गुदम बहिर रुक्ष दुर्बल देहस्य तम गुद भ्रंशाभिषेक. This is actually very little amount of references of gud bhransh is found in Ayurveda. This is the shloka of Shushrut. He has stated in Nidan Sthan that in the patient, those who are emaciated, weak with ruksh prakriti, or you can say those who in which the vataj prakriti has been prominent in those patient, if they are suffering from diarrhea, dysentery, and they do the pravaha, means they forcefully, they produce out, they do pravaha, then their gudam nirgachati, means then their rectum produces out. So this is the reference that is found in the Acharya Shushrut Nidanasthan 30. What are the predisposing factors for this? Predisposing factors, as again said in Ayurveda also, straining, that is pravahan. Straining is most important factor, that patient used to strain, patient are suffering from chronic constipation. So after that, they used to strain and it may lead to the prolapse rectum. Diarrhea is also a cause. Pregnancy or repeated childbirth can also lead to the weakening of the pelvic floor muscles and can lead into this, or prior previous surgeries have happened that can also lead to this, or other are neurological diseases. Now we come to the examination. So if we talk about the examination, this is in, we come to inspection. In this, we can see this first picture, this red color mass. Red color mass is large red color mass. This shows the prolapse rectum. So in initial examination, if the prolapse is on its initial stage, or it is partial, or it may be the complete, even though the prolapse is frequently reduced. But in the later cases, the prolapse may or may not get reduced. Anal orifice is quite patulous, that is, their sphincter is lax, laxity is present, so it becomes patulous. And if the patient is asked to bear down, when you will find it out, then it will found that the full thickness of the rectal wall will collapse. And you can see the concentric folds in this picture. It is clearly mentioning that there is a concentric folds are there. Somewhere in second picture, you can see this is the picture of hemorrhoids. It is not a picture of prolapsed rectum, because in this it can be seen that the prolapse that is coming out in the its radial folds, not in concentric folds. Also, if the prolapse is complete and it has been come out outside of the anal verge, so it can cause the repeated trauma, due to which superficial ulceration can also be present. Now, one more thing, if the patient is unable to show its prolapse in earlier cases, then the position that has to be advised to the patient is squatting position. The patient is always asked to sit in the squatting position and bear down to demonstrate the prolapse. In cases of female, the rectal prolapse can be associated with the uterine prolapse or cystosis. Now coming to the palpation examination, digital examination is the very important examination because it can tell us the tone of the sphincteric muscle. So the sphincteric tone will be either diminished or reduced or laxative. Then we can see the contraction of this muscle, how much of the sphincteric muscle can contract. So it will be either deficient or it will be the absent. And also when in a normal patient who is having the normal sphincteric tone, if we go for the distal examination, patient feels somewhat of the discomfort. But in such patients who are suffering from prolapsed rectum, the lack of discomfort is experienced. That is, their patient will not have and thus that kind of discomfort. So, bidistal palpation of the prolapsing tissue that will reveal that entire bowel thickness is involved in case of prolapsed rectum. Now we come to the differential diagnosis. So we will make the differential diagnosis with mucosal prolapse, complete rectal procedentia, internal hemorrhoids, or any large polypoidal neoplasm. So all these has to be made differences by the symptoms, by taking the symptoms, what are the symptoms present at that time by distal examination or by the help of some investigations like sigmoidoscopy, colonoscopy, barium enema, TRUS, or other, that will confirm the diagnosis. Now, what are the clinical features of this rectal prolapse? Clinical features includes the protrusion of the rectal mass because of the laxity and the sphincter, and that pelvic floor muscles have been weak, and thus it will protrude, the rectum will protrude out. Also, there can be the rectal bleeding due to the presence of the congestion, mucoid discharge may be present secondarily. Tenesmus may be present, constipation may be present, chronic constipation may lead to the chronic straining, and in turn it may lead to the prolapsed rectum. Fecal incontinence, that is very commonly found, usually 60 to 75% of the patients, they are having the history of fecal incontinence. Along with this, 35% of the patient are having the urinary incontinence. And vaginal wall prolapse in 15% of the patient, female patient, they are suffering from vaginal wall prolapse. Now we will come to the etiology. Etiology is of prolapsed rectum, like weakening of the supportive tissue. Now here we can talk about the anatomical defect. This can include the anatomical defect even, and also with instead weakening of the tissues that are supporting the rectum, like defect in the pelvic floor or weakening of the pelvic floor along with the diastasis of the levator and eye muscle. Or along with, in case of females, if there is an abnormally deep cul-de-sac of Douglas is present there, in that case, even there is a weakening of supporting tissue can be present. Or if we talk about the anal sphincters, if they are weak or they are patulous, then also it can lead to it. Second is increased intra-abdominal pressure. If the intra-abdominal pressure is increased for any of the reason, maybe prolonged coughing, maybe prolonged sneezing, prolonged constipation or pregnancy or any tumor or neoplasm, etc. If it is increasing the intra-abdominal pressure, it can cause the loosening of the attachment of the sacrum and the pelvis wall. Children, yes, of course, in case of the children also, it is found as the children's or small children's, we are talking about the young children's under the age of the 5 years, because they have the undeveloped or underdeveloped sacral nerve. And also their anal tone is decreased. This in turn increases the formation of prolapse sacrum. Now, the most important part is how we can make the diagnosis and how can we evaluate the cases of the prolapse rectum. The most important part comes is history taking. So the proper history taking has to be taken to make the proper diagnosis. So the as we know, one thing, first of all thing, we know that these cases are found in the extreme of ages. So when the patient is coming under 5 or above 50-60, we have to keep in mind that the patient can be of prolapse rectum. Second thing, that is the patient has to be inquire about other cases also, whether patient is having the history of something prolapsing outside, because patient will come, patient gives the history of, or patient always complain of that something is coming out per rectal, and that can spontaneously also come out while standing, walking, sneezing, coughing, and it can be repositioned inside or cannot, patient cannot, even cannot. Then this also gives, clinches the diagnosis of prolapse rectum and also the associated symptoms of the presence or absence of other symptoms like mucoid discharge, inquire about their bowel habit, inquire about their control of the defecation, whether they have the control over the defecation or not. All total things we have to ask. And also if the patient is female, then we have to look for associated vaginal prolapse, because patients, female patients, along with rectal prolapse, they usually have the vaginal wall prolapse also, like cystocene, etc. Now we will come to the examination. How we will examine the patient of prolapse rectum. So while examining, we have to look for the perianal skin. Perianal skin, whether it is excoriated or it is normal. As if the complete prolapse is there and prolapse is coming repeatedly outside, somewhere trauma occurs to the skin and it leads to the excoriation of the perianal skin, which in turn can lead to the secondary fungal or bacterial infection. Then we have to look for the concentric rings or group to rule out whether it is prolapse or any other case which we have discussed in the differential diagnosis. Whether patient is of chronic prolapse or not, examination can include the biopsies. If we suspect of any of the neoplasms there, then digital examination and sphincter pressure has to be examined. Now we will go for the investigations. Investigations includes the like a few examinations like barium enema. After our OPD label, we have to send patient to diagnostics so that we can confirm our diagnosis. What is the diagnosis? Barium enema, just to rule out whether the patient is suffering from neoplasm, inflammatory bowel disease, or any of the diverticular diseases. Then we can go also for the spine radiographs, especially for the lumbar region or the pelvis, to rule out the neurological diseases like spina bifida. Colonoscopy or sigmoidoscopy to rule out the granuloma, malignancies, or the prevalence of the CA. Actually, the prevalence of rectosigmoid CA along with the prevalence, along with the prolapse is almost 5 to 8%. So just to rule out it, colonoscopy or the sigmoidoscopy is important. Next is anal manometry. Anal manometry is very important for the physiological testing of the rectum, because as we read about the different pressures like resting pressure, squeezing pressure. The resting pressure is usually 40, it is 40 to 80 roundabout, and squeezing, and it is the pressure of the internal sphincters, and squeezing pressure usually remains about 80-90, and it is the pressure of the external sphincters. So anal manometry measures the pressure at the various points of the anal canal. And what is done in this, some water filled balloons are placed inside the anal canal and it is attached to the transducers that is placed there, and they measures the pressures. Then diffeography. Diffeography is again, it measures that they rule out the mega rectum, like mega rectum, patient is suffering from mega rectum or some solitary ulcer syndromes. This can be ruled out by diffeography. TRUS is transrectal ultrasonography or endoanal ultrasonography. This is very commonly used nowadays, ultrasonogram that is done in anal region. And it rules out both qualitative and quantitative things of the anal region or rectum. So in qualitative, it's find out the morphological changes that is found in the anal canal, like distortion of some mucosa, etc. While when we talk about the quantitative examination, it tells the anal sphincters and the submucosal thickness of that particular area can be told by this TRUS or endoanal ultrasonography. MRI also clearly shows the pelvic visceral prolapse and the pelvic floor configuration even on the straining. So it is also very helpful. Then comes this pudendal nerve latency study. It is it can be done. It is in this what is used, that is specialized transducers attached gloves are there. These can be wear on our fingers and then it is inserted while doing the distal examination. So it tells about the prolapse rectum. It check the normal what is the pudendal nerve its value of its latency study, that is normal is around about 1.8 to 2.5 milliseconds. If it is prolonged, then the case is of prolapse rectum. Now coming to the management. So management can be done under two things, that is conservative and various surgical procedures. The choices depends on the patient. Conservative management, so we have to treat the constipation. Patient should not be constipated. So high fiber supplements or stool softeners can be given along with the pharmacological therapies that can be given either Ayurvedic or a modern as per required by the patient. Now, first we will deal about the children. So in case of children, if there is a prolapse in infants or in children, the distal repositioning has to be done once the patient is inside the OPD. And then parent has to be teased how it has to be repositioned, and also the toilet training, proper toilet training has to also be teased to parents and their children. Then other is some mucosal injections can be given in this. 5% of phenol can be given in almond oil. These injections are given submucosally. And occasionally, if required, surgeries can be done. Surgical treatment, it depends on the whether the patient is in what condition. So one thing that patient is healthy adult. Second, that submucosal injections that were given in the children, that can also be given in these patient also, or excision of prolapse mucosa can be done. And the surgeries need two approaches. One is perineal approach and another is the abdominal approaches. So perineal approaches, with the most common operation is Thiers operation. In this, what happens that in this, it is aimed to place the steel wire actually, and around the anal canal, the steel wire or nylon suture or the elastic wires have been placed around the anal canal. But nowadays it is obsolete because its popularity has been decreased because often what happens that sutures get break off. And it can lead to sepsis or some where what happens because of the steel wire, there anal stenosis occur, and if it is created, so it is very severe. Delorme's operation, in this rectal mucosa is removed circumferentially along from the prolapsed rectum along the wall, and then series of sutures are kept down. In Altmaier's procedure, in this excision, in this also the prolapse rectum ka excision karte hain, so along with the associated sigmoid colon that has come outside. Then we come to the abdominal approach. The main principle of the abdominal approach for rectal prolapse is one, that is to replace the rectum, and second, to hold the rectum in its proper position. So these are only recommended in those patients, one, those who are willing to get their abdominal operation done, second, those who are in good health. So this is also depend on the choice of patient also, and also along with the doctor. So many operations are there, including from Wells operation, lip stains, to rectopexy, and it is up to the choice. This is somewhat about the Ripstein's technique. I'm moving out. So now coming to the what are the complications of the surgery? That is, many times what happens after the surgery, there is an injury to the hypogastric nerve, and that may cause the impotence. Bladder dysfunction may be present. Bleeding can occur from sacral venous plexus. Injury to rectum and colon, it can occur, that may cause the fecal fistula. Constipation can occur after rectopexy. Already patient was suffering from constipation that has led to the prolapsed rectum, and even after the operation, a patient is suffering from constipation, then it comes under the complications. Recurrence of prolapse can occur. Improper correction of continence, infection, and abscess, that are most common things. So now coming, what is the choice of the treatment? This is the important thing while treating a patient of prolapsed rectum. What is the choice of the treatment? What is the aim of the treatment? The aim of the treatment is one, to control the prolapse, to restore the continence, and to prevent the constipation. So to follow these three, we have to give the result, but as discussed above, all of them, none can give 100% satisfactory result. So to overcome these issues, a new therapy has been advised, that is EECS. EECS is encircling or encirclement of anal canal by Charsooth. So why Charsooth was developed for this? Because of the surgical failure. When there was surgical failure, so some of the alternative therapy was required. And also, Acharya Shushruth has also advised Charsooth therapy in weak and surgically unfit patient. In those also we can use it, or in those where there is a recurrence, in those, or even though those patients which are healthy, in children, we can easily use this Charsooth therapy with very good result. Again, now, as I told, all the investigation prior to the procedure, investigations has to be performed, all the blood investigations, urine investigations, all those pathological investigations along with radiological investigations if required, and viral markers. What is the beautifulness of this procedure is that it takes only 10 to 15 minutes of the time for doing this procedure. Before this procedure, preoperatively written and well explained consent has to be taken from the patient. Without consent, no patient has to be admitted in the admitted for doing this case. Part preparation has to be done. A soap water enema has to be given a night a day previously and in the early morning of the operation day. Injection tetanus toxide can be given, and xylopen sensitivity test has to be done. Patient's position is the lithotomy position, and this process do not require any of the major anesthesia. This can be done in local anesthesia. Now these are few pictures that I'm showing to demonstrate the process of EECS therapy. In these pictures, you can see this is the local infiltration of 2% xylocaine with adrenaline around the external anal orifice. Around this orifice, we insert a local infiltration of 2% xylocaine. After that, a stab incision is given at 12 o'clock position. Then a Charsooth is inserted from 12 o'clock position to 6 o'clock position. Again, the same procedure is repeated from the second opposite side, and it has been taken out at 6 o'clock position. Now, in this procedure, the tightening and assessing of the anal canal is done. This procedure needs the help of an assistant. ask the patient assistant to tie the knot while surgeon has to assess the tone of the anal canal ki at what tone we have to tie the this charsutra. And here the tightening of the charsutra has been done. After this, this is the picture, knot has been tied at 6 o'clock position. And after this, the same patient, you can see the complete recovery after the 15 days. The recovery period may depend on a patient. It may vary to patient, maybe 15 days, maybe 21 days. This is the serial photography that has been done, and it is shown the patient is of prolapsed rectum, charsutra ligation, cutting of the thread after 15 days. And then after cutting of the thread, this is the picture. And after 21 days, this is the total picture of the patient. That patient is having very good tone and no prolapse is there. Now, what are the criteria of assessment? How can we assess whether we are going on the right track or not? So we have to see the time taken to formation of ring in prolapse rectum in days. How much time it takes to form a ring. Complete healing time is seen, pain relief day when patient get relief. Analysis of the sphincter tone, it can be done either by anal manometry or distal rectal examination scoring system. Serial photography just to run to assess our case, analysis of anal continuous. Patient is called for follow-up for the days 1, 3, 7, 15, 21, and 30 after charsutra ligation. Then he or she can be called fortnightly for 3 months and then followed by 6 months so that the total follow-up can be done. Patient can be given adjuvant therapies too. These are the few patient pictures before EECS therapy and after EECS therapy. Now, patients who are on EECS therapy, they have been given the advice, one, not to increase the abdominal pressure too much after defecation. Possibly, they should use a mild laxative and use the high vibrance diet. Now, coming to the conclusion, it involves the minimal degree of surgical trauma and it can even be performed on the OPD basis. It do not require abdominal surgeries, no cutting, no mucosal removal, no stitching, nothing is required. It is very safe technique, so can be used in children, even in elderly, in those who do not want any kind of the surgeries. In those patients, it can be easily used. No chance of any anal sphincter injury or any penny anal tissue loss is there. And duration of treatment is very less. Patient can be sent home same day and can be called for the follow-up. No pain, no discomfort, little, little or minimal pain or less discomfort is there. It can be done in local anesthesia. Cost of treatment is very minimal. So it can also be tried in rural areas also where the minimal surgical facilities are available. As these very few data are present right now, so further studies on this technique so that number of patients can increase, so to evaluate the merits and demerits of the technique. Finally, I would like to say the success of treatment depends not only on the treatment modality, but also on the experience of surgeon and also the joint action of patient and the surgeon. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your patience listening. Thank you to all.
Thank you, Dr. Varsha Madam.
Welcome, sir.
You have explained in a very simple manner, a very unique technique that is therapy for the management of rectal prolapse. As we all know that rectal prolapse, it is a condition which is quite difficult for a patient as well as a surgeon to manage it. And you have explained it in a very effective manner. That is just a 10 to 15 minutes OPD procedure.
Yes, sir.
Which can reduce all the surgical complications and the another thing. So thank you very much for your very nice presentation, and we hope that by this platform many of the surgeons, they will come to know about these techniques and they will treat their patient. And as you are expected that we should need a huge data for such works, so it may increase the number of patients and or the attitude of patients or the diversion of the patients to our pathy. So it's a very nice presentation, Varsha.
Thank you very much, sir.
So before going to the chairman's review on this. I would like to invite our audience, if they are having some questions, they can ask.
Yeah, there are some questions, sir. You can take from the chat box.
Okay. One of the questions from chat box, that is partial rectal prolapse and complete rectal.
Will you please stop sharing so connectivity will increase?
Yeah.
Okay. Very nice, ma'am. Thank you. It was really great.
Okay, there is one question.
Thank you, sir.
He asked the question that, is there any classification regarding partial rectal prolapse and complete rectal prolapse with age-wise or three-dose-wise classification?
Sir, I think he wants to know the difference between partial and complete prolapse rectum. If he would...
Okay, I think Dr. Suranaik Patnaik, madam, will you unmute him and he will directly ask the question to our expert?
Yes. Yeah, Dr. Patnaik, sir. Namaskar, please.
Good afternoon, madam. Thank you. Madam, age wise, I am asking age wise and three doses wise.
No, sir. I have not seen it in Tridosh wise, whether the Tridosh wise is there or not. Till now, I haven't seen. Maybe it may present, but I don't know right now. Actually, this was my PhD work. But even though that time, even I have not seen, it has been classified according to the Dosh wise.
Chairman, sir,
according to age in modern.
Sir.
And yeah. According to modern age wise, yeah, of course.
Age wise,
if we talk about age wise, usually in children, partial or mucosal prolapse is present. Which can be treated itself.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, madam. Yes, any other questions from? Or you may drop a question in chat box also, that we can take the question at the end of the second session. We can also take the session. Okay, now before inviting our chairman, Dr. Dudhmaj sir, for his remark, I want to just give a brief introduction of Dr. Dudhmaj sir. Dr. Tukaram Sambhaji Dudhmaj sir, he is currently working as associate professor and in charge head of the department Shalya Tantra in Institute of Teaching and Research in Ayurveda, Jamnagar, Gujarat. He has obtained his PG degree from Nanded and PhD Shalya Tantra from Gujarat Ayurveda University, Jamnagar. His teaching experience is 20 years to post-graduation and clinical experience is more than 20 years. He guided about 29 PG students and 12 PhD students. 3 books are published and 10 chapters of Ayurveda are in his credit. He has published around 180 research articles in referred journals. He has delivered more than 45 guest lectures in CMEs, national and international seminars. He has completed 5 research projects as a principal investigator and 2 projects they are ongoing. He has worked as a reviewer and subject editor in scientific journals like IU and IU Log, JIM, and The Healer, and many more. He has visited Kazakhstan, Russia, Sri Lanka, China, and Hungary with various responsibilities to deliver the lectures for the propagation of Ayurveda, Char Sutra, and wound healing. His areas of expert that includes wound healing, Char Sutra, anorectal surgery, leech application, musculoskeletal disorders, urinary system disorders through Ayurveda. So we are fortunate that we are having such a dynamic personality as a chairperson of this session. So I invite respected Dr. T.S. Dudhmaj sir for his chairman review. Dr. Dudhmaj sir.
Thank you, sir. It is audible?
Yes, yes, sir. You are clearly audible.
Thank you, Professor Nitin, sir, for your kind words. First of all, I would like to congratulate to the guest speaker, Dr. Varsha Saxena ji, for her informative and very simplified lecture. Really, she highlighted basic things starting from the anatomy, physiology, and then Ayurved portion, as well as the details about the etiological factors, then symptoms, then differential diagnosis, and then required investigations to diagnose. And lastly, she highlighted the conservative as well as the surgical portion of the rectal prolapse. Yes, really, rectal prolapse, if it is a partial, it can be manageable. But in complete prolapse, there are surgeries, but they are having their own limitations. Obviously, not in surgical discipline, when there are different kinds of procedures, it indicates the prognosis is not good of that particular disease. And in rectal prolapse too, many factors are there. Even though surgery, there is a recurrence or incontinence, issues are there. The topic was very well described and explained. So how to apply the Kshara Sutra and what is the recovery in the photograph, that easily understand each and every surgical discipline as well as non-surgeon persons too. And in this, one scholar had asked the questions regarding the dosic involvement. So usually what happens, particularly whenever we are dealing with the surgery, we are not concentrate on this aspect in which dosic involvement is there, because ultimately we are going for the surgery. But in some cases, we can differentiate on the basis of symptoms. If excess discharge is there, we can say a kuffage. But what is the meaning of that if you are differentiate also? So that our main concentration is to have the complete recovery. If anywhere we are giving to the conservative measures, then we can differentiate. If pain is more, then we can say that vatic involvement is more and discharge is more, then we can say that kapha predominance is more. So Dr. Saxena ji, you are very well described the rectal prolapse, and it is a very innovative, I think, if it is useful in the complete rectal prolapse. But as you are rightly saying, it needs to do study in more number of cases. And as per my knowledge, you have studied in, I think, more than 50 cases. This is a PhD work, right?
Yes, sir. Sir, it was more than
50. So I just have to curiosity to know, if in complete prolapse, how many months you have to do the follow-up that cases? Because follow-up is very, very important. You are rightly saying ki, after etiological factors, if intra-abdominal pressure is increased, then there is chances of the recurrence, right? So yes, in how many cases there is a recurrence after your PhD work?
Sir, the recurrence was very minimal. One patient of complete rectal prolapse was their recurrence, and I didn't see the incomplete prolapse for recurrence.
Okay, so
follow-up was for 1 year.
So we can say 5 to 6% only recurrence is there,
yes,
right?
Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So how many cases we find any complications in the form of any abscess formation or if infection?
Yes, sir. Sir, in few patients I found the where we prick the needle for inserting the charsuit, at that point there was the small abscess was there. Abscess was there in few patients. Likewise, 5-6 patients there was.
My concern is whenever we are innovating such type of new techniques, so you should add this only 5 to 6% or only 10%, it may happen, because particularly in the pitta predominant prakriti, the tissue reaction is more to the Kshara Sutra when you are putting in fistula also. So when you're putting this in the normal tissue, particularly in the encircling the anal canal, so in such cases there may be chances of the just simply inflammation or sometimes infection. But that can be controlled with the antibiotics or other measures. Okay, that is not the issue. But if with this simplified technique, if patient can get cured completely, particularly in the precedency or complete prolapse, then that is a very good thing for Ayurveda.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
So
yes.
Once again, I congratulations to you, and I thanks to the organizer and moderator as well as coordinator for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Namaskar, sir.
Namaste.
You are muted, sir. Nitin, sir, you are muted.
Thank you, Dr. Dudmal sir. You are really point out the important things, and that may enhance to the other researchers also that what point should be included in their research. Okay. It is not in the protocol, but as our next guest, Dr. Patil sir has also joined. So I can ask him if he has any opinion or view regarding the topic presented by our first speaker, Dr. Varsha madam. Dr. Patil sir.
Yes, sir. Hello.
Yes, sir. Sir,
namaste.
Namaste, sir. Can you please enlighten something on the topic presented by Dr. Varsha madam?
I joined late. I could not go through this one because it was a very rare year.
Okay,
I joined late. So it is a good
topic. I think the question from Dr. Snehal, Dr. Nitin sir.
Yes.
Dr. Snehal ma'am ka question hai ek chat box mein. Usko aap lijiyega to discussion ho jayega.
Okay, sure.
It's similar like three wiring. What will be the time duration to cut off the Kshar-sutra, or what are the criteria for such decision?
Yes, I have listened to the question. Actually, it is similar to Thiers. Exactly. It is modified Thiers form. But what happens in Thiers, once we placed a wire in this, that has to be kept for the whole life. Okay, and it can create the stenosis even, or sepsis, or inflammatory sepsis. But in this case, when we use the Kshar-sutra in this, we used to remove it in 15 days. If it by assessing the anal tone, if the anal tone has been come, because it creates the inflammatory fibrosis in this. The Kshar-sutra creates the inflammatory fibrosis, and also it gives the mechanical support. So after 15 days of assessment, we check out the anal sphincter and we can remove it. If we suspect little bit ki, the proper healing has not been occurred or proper tone has not come back, then we can wait for a week also, and then we have to remove the Kshar-sutra. We don't leave the Kshar-sutra in situ. While in case of Thiers, the whatever the thing we are using, whether it is nylon or wire or steel wire, it has to be left in situ for whole life.
Did the knot get out because of its cutting nature? One question is there in chat box.
Pardon, sir?
Did the Kshar-sutra not get out because of its cutting nature? It is a question in the chat box.
Yes, sir. Kshar-sutra cut the tissues. It itself get dissolved in due course of time, but it can be, it usually is seen that if the patient do not come after 7 days of the sitting, in cases of the fistula, we call the patient weekly after the interval of 7 days to change the Kshar-sutra, just to see one thing, that is Kshar has been dissolved, its activity has been already done for cutting and healing, and second, because the thread is cotton thread, so it usually break out. But it is seen in cases of fistula even, if patient do not come for a week and it come, he or she comes for fortnightly, even though thread remain inside. So it is seen the patient can take this Kshar-sutra in situ for 15 days or 20 days, it can be kept there. This is not
that means all the fistula is under monitor and we are monitoring the patient, that's why we can come to know if there is any complication or any thing that should be assessed. Thank you.
Okay.
It is a very nice session and very nicely explained by Dr. Varsha ma'am. And thanks to our chairperson and all participants. Now we will move to our next session. The topic of the next session, that is Ayurveda approach towards trauma and fracture. Many times we come to know that in Ayurveda there is only anorectal surgery, or sometimes there is some general surgery is there. But as we know that there is also some vaidyas or some surgeons in India who are practicing this surgery or Ayurvedic therapy in trauma and fracture management. So our next speaker, Professor Dr. Siddhana Gowda sir, he is expert in trauma and fracture management through Ayurveda. Dr. Siddhana Gowda sir, he is a professor in PG and PhD studies, Department of Shalya Tantra, Ayurved Mahavidyalaya, Hubli, Karnataka. Sir is recognized PhD guide from Rajiv Gandhi Health University of Sciences, Bangalore. He is an Academy Council member, Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences. He is Joint Secretary, National Susut Association, Karnataka State Branch. He is President, Arogya Bharati, Karnataka State. Sir has completed his graduation from Ayurved Mahavidyalaya Hubli and his postgraduate and PhD in Shalya Tantra from SDM Group of College, that is in Hasar. And one other thing I want to highlight here, that sir is the first PhD awardee of Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences in surgery subject. For that he was felicitated also. Sir is receiver of lots of awards. Among them, in recently 2021, Vaidya Ratna Award is a state level award was given to Dr. Sridhar Gowda sir. Vaidya Sanjeevani Award in 2019, Sevaratna Award in 2017, Basava Rashtriya Prasidh Award in 2013, and during his graduation, he received a Best Boy Award in 2001. So he is a really very dynamic person. He is having experience in very vast and includes hands-on training. So I invite our next speaker, Dr. Patil sir, for the lecture.
Thank you, Dr. Nitin sir. First of all, I congratulate a previous speaker. I could not able to attend early. I excuse for that, and I took permission from Dr. Shilpa madam also.
Thank you, sir.
On the occasion of National Ayurveda Day, Ayush Darpana Foundation, Dehradun, has organized this special event on different topics of Ashtanga Ayurveda. Especially, I thank Vaidya Dr. Ashutosh Kulkarni sir, respected Dr. Dudmal sir, respected Dr. Nitin sir, and the organizers, Dr. Naveen Joshi sir, and Dr. Shilpa madam, and Dr. Arvind Patak sir, and all the respected members of this association, and all the participants who are encouraging and taking the benefit of this special event. Sure. Madam, is it visible? Hello?
Yes, sir, visible.
Yeah. Shall I move? I welcome all of you for this special plan, that is orthopedics in Ayurveda, or orthopedics branch in Bhagna Chikitsa, what better we can call like that. The person behind this all, the Bhagna Chikitsa or the orthopedics, established most of the principles of surgery from thousand years back, and the first time in the history of surgery, the father of surgery, Sushruta. I submit my humble pranamas to the lotus feet of Lord Dhanvantri and Sushruta and all my respected teachers. Then I will move on to my topic, an Ayurvedic approach towards trauma and fracture. They have given a title like trauma and fracture. Trauma is a cause, better I can understand, and fracture is a result of that trauma. Like this, we can understand this. So how it is important, why it is important is, approach to human elements is as old as evolution of the human being from the day invention. The orthopedic surgery, whatever is it, told, and we practice even the most advanced technology like lengthening procedures, like a person is a dwarf who can become a particular height, this lengthy, with the principle of Eliezerov technique. The most of the principles with an advanced physics and so many things in this, and it was started in the 18th century by Nicolas Andry, started a French Paris physician. The deformity of the limbs were there because of the rickets in those days. So ortho is a straight, pedix is a correction of the pediatric's limb. That's how it has started, orthopedics. And whatever traumatic the things like fracture, dislocation, sprain, strain, infectious diseases, the degenerative diseases, all these, if you take into consideration, all will come and lie under the heading called as Bhagna Chikitsa. Bhagna is a broad term under which we can study all the ailments. So why it is important and why the Sushruta has given a more important for this is, those days they have horse and other things for the riding purpose. The important thing here is, if a person is suffering with a fracture or dislocation, it directly affects his family life and social life. So it disturbs the economical status of an individual and also social status of an individual. That's how it is very important. There is a constant search is going on till today in allied sciences and other science also. There is no remedy which can reduce the duration of healing, which can reduce the duration of immobilization, which can plan an early union and other things. In this regard, when we search into our classics, Sushruta, in the context of Chikitsa, third chapter of Sushruta, Chikitsa Sthana, Bhagna Chikitsa, he highlighted about certain principles and certain medicaments which can help to make a bone strong, stable, and heal faster with whatever is a modern text mentions the duration for upper limb, lower limb, and other bones, which can be definitely reduced if you are implemented properly. Hence, the Sushruta's principles of Bhagna Chikitsa, even till today, they deserve an appreciation. The one important thing what we can highlight today is Laksha Kshirpaka. It's a very unique preparation which can give an early healing and osteoblastic activity in the individual who has fractured and who is having this problem. So it is a very important topic, I can say. The present statistics, what we can go for the incidence is, it is the one musculoskeletal injuries, it's one of the fourth leading cause of death in this universe, India and other abroad. The long bone fractures are especially as diaphyseal fractures, what we can call as a shaft fractures of the radius, ulna, femur, humerus, tibia, fibula, all these leads into a 74.5%. Rotrophic injuries, if you take a major health problem worldwide, about 3,000 people die as a 30,000 are seriously injured in the world roads by different sectors like mining, construction, manufacturing, in different ratios they suffer. The males have a significant higher rate than the females is about a 2:1 ratio. Every year, 1.9 million hospitalized due to an injury, and 29% deaths are due to the motor vehicle accidents. Financial loss due to a road traffic accident is about 12,000 crores per year in India, Indian scenario. The global financial cost of RTA injuries is about $518 billion per year. Looking into the picture, it is a very, very troublesome, and it is a both social and economical loss to the individual. Being an Ayurvedic doctor, we should know something about how the dhatu, the fifth dhatu, the asthi, how it is nourished, how it is formed, everything is explained by Panchabhautikatva and other things. I don't think it is necessary. In Ayurveda, they classify five types of bone like Kapala, Ruchaka, Taruna, Valaya, and Nalaka. Whatever you studied today is the classification by other orthopedics or osteology books, all comes under this five headings only. The only number differs is modern says 206 and our Acharya says 360 and 300. Even the minute part like cartilage and nails, they never left because they will also go into a trauma and injury, the result into a problem. So they also consider all these things, hence the number varies. When you go for a definition of Bhagna, the word itself suggests Banja, the one word, it can give many meanings, and all the conditions, whatever I explained previously, like a fracture, dislocation, sprain, strain, and most of the conditions under this heading only. That's what I highlighted here. The different synonyms has also been given based on the type of injury, based on the tissue involved, like a sandhi chuti. There is a tear in the joint. There is a tear in the ligament of the joint. Bhanga, there is a different pieces break into two different pieces like the bhanga. And also Susruta had an idea of how this trauma will affect over the different types of parts of the body, like a bone, cartilage, teeth, flat bone, long bone. All these get different types of patterns of fractures. That's what the reference says, and I have mentioned here also. Coming into the thing, like there are various types of injury. A person with a very muscular, with the fighting with another person, he may not get suddenly a fracture, because body has got its own resistance power to sustain about from that particular hit, injury or a blow. At the same time, in the elderly individual, when there is a sudden slip, you take an example, if a person while driving suddenly hits to his limb, he may get an injury. We call it is a trauma. It is a traumatic fracture. If a person in the while going into the bathroom suddenly slipped down and fell down and got an injury, it is a degenerative problem. It is also, we call it is a low energy injury or a trivial trauma. A minimal injury, a force is required to cause that is a trivial trauma. It is a pathological fracture we can call. These are different classification mentioned by Sushruta and other acharyas also. Mainly two kinds, Sandhimokta and Khandavagna, like fracture and dislocation. These are the sub varieties of the fractures. In the same other contemporary science also, they classify like a traumatic fracture, pathological, one classification. Another goes an undisplaced and displaced. Like the different types of patterns of fracture depending on the type of injury, like transverse, oblique, spiral, comminuted, and segmental. Why I shown this picture and highlighted about these things here? When you take into the management principles, definitely the healing differs compared to the spiral to that of the transverse or comminuted or segmental. If the spiral, there is a wide area of fracture area, there is a wide area of approximation. So the healing will be faster compared to the transverse fracture. So that's what the clinical importance lies in this type of patterns of fractures. Again, the complete fracture or partial fracture, like a green streak fracture. In pediatrics, usually we get only one cortex is broken. That's called as a green streak. Like a stable fracture and unstable, where there is a fracture, it is difficult to manage by close reduction. That is an unstable. Where you can able to do it, it is a stable fracture. There are various injuries like epiphyseal or metaphyseal and diaphyseal. The epiphyseal injuries are common injuries in pediatrics. If anything goes wrong, there is a shortening. There will not be a growth of an individual bone at that particular, because epiphysis is a tip where it is a growing end. Anything epiphysis is a, which is a covering of the bone, it is get injured, it will not heal. That's what. These are the different types of name given based on the individual who have described this one, like a night stick fracture, where you get sudden support, the policeman hits to a particular part, you get the fracture, is called as a night stick. Quartz fracture, like a bilateral malleolar fracture, like a dashboard injury, like the Bennett fracture, which we commonly come across in the hands. Montage and Galazia fractures are usually a common fractures in the forearm on either side of the bone. The Cooley's fracture, the commonest fracture which we come across in the elderly woman because of the degeneration. The exactly reverse fracture is called as a Smith's fracture, where there is a fracture at the lower end of the radius, 3.75 centimeter from the wrist joint, with the dorsal displacement, is called as Cooley's. If it is in the ventral displacement of the distal fragment, we call it a Smith's fracture. These are the stress fracture, Barton's fracture, all these things based on the type of fracture and the person who had described. The causes for a fracture is previously mentioned by our acharyas, which I highlighted, abhighata visheshai. Whatever cause it may be, the most important thing in those days they highlighted is abhighata. Even till today, the cause for the fracture is abhighata. The most common is rotrophic injuries. So this is what I am going to highlight. Immediately after fracture, there is a reaction of the tissue and you can diagnose it based on the clinical grounds like Acharya has highlighted. There is a huge swelling. There is a jerky movements is restricted. There is a deformity like a dinner fork deformity, which I have shown on the slide. If you see the dinner fork, especially with an example of Cooley's fracture, you come across dinner fork deformity. There is a huge tenderness because of the accumulation of blood in that particular area. There is a tissue reaction due to the injury. The huge tenderness will be there. Because of the fracture and the multiple fragments, there is a crepitation is also appreciated. See how carefully the acharyas has explained. Nowadays, we get in all this information with the advanced technology of the physics and radiology. In those days, based on their yukti, they highlighted about all these things. There is a loss of functioning because of the injury and all these things. There is a different kinds of pain and other things. And in any position, they never get the comfort. So, na sharmaha sukam. Sharmam sukam. Na sarva avasthasu na sharmam. Sharmam, he was not getting comfort. The same thing in different contexts also. And how to diagnose these things? Based on the clinical assessment history, suddenly we get... Doctor, I was riding a vehicle, suddenly I got hit and I fell down and I got injury to my forearm. I was driving my car, suddenly there is a hit and I am getting the pain at the hip joint. Like this, the history, it is important. I got pain, discomfort and there is a fracture. Patient himself comes with this. There may be associated comorbidities are also associated. The history of exposure and systemic examination is very important. Whatever first aid thing is possible, you need to go for that, because immediately after an injury, you try to support, don't allow them to move wherever, however you want, because the injured pointed sharp portions of the fracture pieces may injure the vessels or the nerve. They tend to lead into complications. So it should not be done. Immediately you have to first aid the things, whatever things available at the end. And splintage and other analgesics are required. Once it is shifted, immediately you can go for radiograph. It is very, very essential. Two views are very essential. Even when we come across at the general practice, if the patient comes, immediately we have to write two views, AP and lateral. If the joint is there, AP and oblique. Like these two views are very essential. First aid with the arm sling bandage or the sling bandage is very important to save the further damage, which helps in detecting the fracture of the skull, pelvis and spine, other injuries also. MRI along with the fracture helps to identify the soft tissue injury and the ligamental injury, especially in the joints. What should be our goal to manage the things? We want a functionally, anatomically functioning limb. The restoration of the anatomy and function, that is, anatomy and physiology is important for us. Because if you are managing the fracture without maintaining the functional thing, it is a waste, it is a useless limb for that individual. And important is to restoration of the function as its optimal level. After the management of the fracture, if you could not able to write by taking the pen, what is the use of that one? So optimal functioning is also important for us. And prevention of the complications of soft tissue and the fracture. The complication, one of the important thing is whenever you get an injury, open injury, definitely the bone tissues gets 10 times higher rate than the soft tissue injury. And a very common complication is osteomyelitis, most commonly. It is a lifelong disease associated with him till the last breath. It is a headache to a doctor, headache to the patient, and headache to the attenders. So this Like this, the complications play a major role. Rehabilitate the patient as early as possible. After managing, you try to manage. Active, passive physiotherapy is very, very essential. And I will explain in future whatever principles told by our Sushruta. The general principles is as it is, the management of the first aid efficient, like three other things, ABC and all those things. This is what is required. These are the first aid management, whatever is available, you can go through them. And for this, instead of going for analgesic and other things, in Sushruta Chikitsa, third chapter, Acharya mentioned, Parisheka. Parisheka is nothing but preparing any kashaya with the Vedana Sthapaka drugs in the lukewarm condition, Nevrodadi, like that, highlighted. Immediately after fracture, go for Shita Kashayas and other things because there is a new thing, there is a problem. Later on, you can go for Sukoshna or you can Panchamula Siddha Dugdha. Dugdha is Vata Pittahara, so it is very important to prepare those things. Or you can go for Chakrataila Vatahara. You can plan immediately as it is shown in the diagram. Later on, you can go for the Lepa, which is explained by Sushruta, third chapter. Manjishta, Rakta Chandana, Eshtimadhu, Shatadauta and Shalipishti. All these combinations, if you prepare and apply to that particular thing, which will be very effective in management of these cases. Kusha is applied. Earlier days, they used to use the Shiri Ruksha Kashaya splints for the management of these things. These are the measures which can plan very well in Arana Bhagna. See, while management, Sushruta was very keen enough to highlight Sarana and Arana, how advanced he was with the compound fracture and a simple fracture. The management of compound fracture is differs and simple fracture differs. That's what its idea of Sushruta. The materials required of what was highlighted by Sushruta was Kusha, a bark of the Madhuka, Udumbara, Ashwatha and Arjuna. Because they were concave, they used to fix the limb exactly in that concave cavity. External was rough, internal was very smooth, just to protect the limb. The Alepana purpose, what is told in Sushruta is Manjishta, Madhuka, Rakta Chandana, Shatadauta, Shalipishti. A binding agent, Shalipishti is a rice flour with the binding agent. And the Rakta Chandana and Eshtimadhu and Manjishta were used to reduce the pain and swelling, act as an anti-inflammatory, along with the combination with the Shatadauta Grutta was highlighted. Nowadays, instead of that, we used to use a simple Murchita Grutta also we are using. The Kashayas like Negrodadi, Panchamula, Siddha Kshiri, or all these things are used for Parishekartha. Tailas like Gandha Taila for Pana and Chakra Taila for Parishekartha. Like this, they used to prepare. The techniques of reduction of the fracture was highlighted by golden principles like Anchana, Pidana, Sankshepana, and Bandhana. Even till today, the traction, counter-traction, reduction, retention, rehabilitation, like this, what we get the golden principles, which was highlighted by Sushruta in those days, traction. If it is a fracture and overrided, you try to put a pressure on opposite side in the first slide, you have to bring the both the fractured end in the same alignment. Once you aligned it, you, with the help of counter-traction, you maintain the proper apposition. It is like this. Once it is maintained, you have to keep it in the same position for few more days with the help of splints. After that, go for bandaging with the help of plaster and other things for till the complete union. The same thing is explained in Cooley's fracture, I can tell you. Cooley's fracture is the fracture of the lower end with the outstretched hand fall with the dinner fork deformity. There is a traction and counter traction, palmar flexion and ulnar deviation like this. There is a palmar flexion and ulnar deviation little bit because there is a shortening. So this was highlighted there. And reduction techniques of Cooley's fracture, which we can explain here. If you see both the ends like Stylard process of radius and Stylard process of ulna, they will not lie in the same plane in normal individual. Whereas in case of fracture, they lie in the same plane. Because of that, it need to give a traction and counter traction to align it and then see the whether they are in the same line or not. So this is what the techniques which you can manage easily. These are the different kinds of pushyas or splints they are effectively used. This is one example in case of ankle sprains. Immediately they used to give parisheka, cold water irrigation immediately, and later on you can give the lukewarm water once it reduces. This is what the reduction techniques, and the first slide will highlighting about the styloid process test. Second one is a palmar flexion, then application of the lepa, manjistadi lepa and the plaster of Paris, that is gauze we have kept it. This is a parisheka which you have done, and the application of the kusha or the splint, and then the lepa. This is before treatment, radiographs of that particular thing. This is once again there is a complication which you can see if you use it too much hot, you will get the blebs over that. This is one of the important complication which you have noticed with the kshira lagu puncha panchamoola siddha kshira parisheka was been done. In this photo, my respected teacher Dr. Hemant Kumar and myself doing in my post-graduation at Hassan. This is once again the same thing, parisheka with the lagu panchamoola kashaya. This is a kshiri ruksha kashaya is done. There are different kinds of management of fracture. After that, you need to regain the strength of a muscle by using different techniques. Whatever you told by Susruta, like Mrutpinda, Lavana and Pashana, the same thing as practiced today is with the physiotherapist. The same Mrutpinda Dharana, lighter object from the Pashana Dharana, heavy object. Slowly you can regain the strength, you can do the physiotherapy of the individual. What we can understand by this is the principles of management of Susruta's technique in the Bhagnar still holds good. This is one of the most important thing. How slowly and gradually you can improvise the muscle strength by giving lighter object to the heavier object. This is what the principle we need to understand by this. And he was also very keen enough to give what should be given to the patient, what should be avoided to the patient. Why? Because certain things which can increase the vata definitely affects the healing. Certain things which pacify the vata, the enhancement of the individual health will be induced. And this is what is important. The nutritional status also maintained well, because the healing will directly depends on that also. So brahmanam cha annapana, that's what they highlighted, and shalir mausarasa kshira sarpi usha, all these things highlighted, because which can pacify vata, which can give the bala to the rogi. So this is what you can go for, adopt the good principles of practice of patya, and which can cause vata and other things like lavana, katu, kshara, amla, maituna should be avoided, which can reduce the healing, delays the healing. So those things are allowed, avoided. This is a laksha powder and estimadu, and this is a grita kshira which you have prepared, laksha kshira paka. This is reference in Susruta Chikitsa third chapter. He has given the kshira preparation will be done by laksha estimadu, same thing, grista kshira sa sarpishka madhura aushadha saditam. He highlights about the grista kshira, that means a freshly delivered cow's milk. Why it is important is it is a rich of cholesterol, it is a rich of calcium, which can enhances the calcium mobilization to a fractured area, so it can early formation of the osteoblastic activity. By doing that osteoblastic activity, there will be early callus formation, because we know that there are five stages of fracture healing, like stage of hematoma, stage of granulation tissue, stage of callus formation, stage of remodeling and stage of modeling. This starts with the day 1 to the 10th, the stage of hematoma. Whatever amount of clot is there in between the fracture end, the body has got a mechanism to absorb. By you giving this parisheka, lepa and all these things, we are stimulating the tissue to the body to absorb most of the things, whatever is there in between. By giving this laksha kshirpaka, which helps to stimulate the osteoblastic activity, the osteoprogenitor, osteocytes and the osteoblast cells which are stimulated and which bridges between the fracture end and which helps in the formation of early callus formation. Like this laksha kshirpaka, he highlights about drishta kshira. But all the time, practically, it is difficult. Whatever milk is available, we can take and we can give it to the patient. He also very particular about laksha yuktam prathar bhagnam pibet narahum. In empty stomach of an individual early morning, it has to be given so that absorption will be good at that particular time before tipping. This is what the study has been carried out in SDM College of Ayurveda, Udupi, Kuttupadi. They have given an analysis report which has been done by our study of laksha. This shows a different testimadu. These are the different kinds which were taken. Like even the compound fracture with open reduction and internal fixation also, which you have studied in Karnataka Institute of Medical Sciences at Hubli under the guidance of Dr. Borlali sir, who was accepted our medicine because he had faced so many complications of this open fracture. By giving this laksha kshira, he definitely said that it is helpful in our cases for early callus formation. Like that is an open fracture management and post-fracture management. We have given laksha kshirpaka 100 ml early morning in those patients for a month. These are the different types of grafts. This is what is required. Normal thing is per day, how much adult is required, 500 mg per day, the calcium requirement, what is the plasma level, what is the there in the milk, how much it is there, calcium, and what is the thing it is helpful. So what are the factors causing? So in toto, the nutritional, why this is important, the nutritional value of milk is particularly high due to the balance of the nutrients that compose it, that builders, proteins, carbohydrate, lipids and energy components, they help. Also comprises the functional elements in traces, especially vitamins, enzymes and dissolved gases and salts, especially in the form of phosphate, nitrates and chlorides of calcium, magnesium, potassium and sodium. It also contains dissolved gases like CO2 and nitrogen and other things. In general, goat milk compared to cow milk is less rich in lactose, fat and proteins, but have a similar mineral contents of that one. The study has been taken, that we have taken as a reference for egg, goat milk. For example, goat milk is about 88% water and 11.4% of solids. It contains 3% fat and 8.13% of fat solids. It also comprised of calcium, phosphate about 0.08% and magnesium about 0.21%. It is very, very useful in post-skeletal repair of immense clinical interest. Why? Because in the beginning only, first slide only I told about, there is a very much social and economical loss in the individual. So by reducing the duration of healing, instead of 2 months, if it is possible to heal within 1.5 months, definitely you can save that 15 days economical status of patient will be improvised. Optimal repair of skeletal tissue is necessary in all varieties of elective and reparative orthopedic surgical treatments. Manjistadi lepa is effective analgesic and inflammatory action. The parisheka with the different combinations of drugs is an effective analgesic and anti-inflammatory one. As already discussed, Lakshakshirapaka helps in early callus formation, leading to the early bone healing. It's a very safe, it is a easy preparation, better acceptability and less complications. These are the different references. How the research papers has been conducted, I have collected and displayed. Though it looks to be a very theoretical presentation, but few of the things which we can come across nearby our villages, there are various classical bone setters, traditional bone setters, what we can say. A simple fractures can be managed by an all Ayurvedic surgeons without much complications with a few skills of this bone setting. Once you set the bone, manage, you can give these medicaments. So they will help to early healing and callus formation. And instead of going for other analgesic and other things which can react on a particular skin and disturbs the GI, by giving these medicaments and applications which you can reduce the skin complications and other the GI problems. So this is what an idea of highlighting about the fracture management in Ayurveda in brief. And I thank all the organizers for giving this opportunity, because it is a vast topic. Only thing, the general principles can be able to highlight, because most of the things like Taila Droni, Kapata Shayana, Musuli Prayoga, most of the useful things are highlighted with this last slide of the Thomas Flint, what is explained in present orthopedic text, which was been 5-nailed bed highlighted by our Susruta. With this last photo, I complete my presentation. I thank once again all the organizers, especially Dr. Hemant sir, who was my senior during my post-graduation at SD Mahasan, and who is like my elder brother, given this opportunity, and also all the organizers, especially Shilpa madam, shared all these information. I thank one and all. If any queries, anything is there, it's most welcome. Once again, I thank one and all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam.
Yes, yes. One questions are there. Some questions are there.
Please, madam. Please, please.
Yeah, yeah.
As madam suggested, most of the practitioners are there. So instead of going for theoretical thing, I went on only the general principles and other things.
Yes, yes, sir. Yes. Dr. Dhanukar sir is there.
Yeah.
Dr. Nitin sir is there. Yes, sir. Dr. Nitin sir. Dr. Nitin sir.
Dr. Nitin sir, and Rukman sir and other respected teachers.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Any suggestions also most welcome, respected
yes,
teachers.
Yes, yes. Yes, yes, definitely.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. You have elaborated the subject very nicely, sir. And as we all know that we are using Lakshadi Gugud in the treatment of conservative treatment in many orthopedic conditions and in Sandhivat and all the diseases where there is lack of calcium or calcium deficiency is there, like Abha Gugud and other. But in today's lecture, you have really explained a very good view of according to the management of wound healing purpose and the fracture. So I request the participants, if they are having queries or any questions, they may put in chat box.
Yes, yes. Some questions are there, sir.
Yeah, please.
One question is there.
Yes, sir.
That after manipulation of fracture, how can we help? How can we help the patient?
Malunion of the fracture. Yes, malunion.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes.
After malunion of the fracture, How can we help the patient?
See, already we know it is a malunion. We should not encourage to heal it once again, because our aim is to correction of the anatomy. If it is already malunited, again you have to go for refracture and try to correct it if it is a major thing is there. If it is a simple thing which is not possible to hamper completely the functional aspect of the limb, there we can give certain things like external applications and physiotherapy. You can reduce that. We can plan the management in case of malunion, sir, according to me.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Any other question?
Sir, okay. One more question is there.
Yeah, sir. Madam. Please, madam.
Actually, due to network issue, I was out of the meet, sir. Yes. That's why I can't see the question, ma'am.
Sir, yes, I will ask. Children complains pains at flank. Ongoing X-ray, no of hairy or in ribs, no history of any abhigataj except mother beaten to the control the hyperactivity of the children. So, except the bhagna, asti, mardava, how we prevent the symptoms shown in early ages. And in Raj Ekshma, what is the treatment and duration in Ayurveda related chikitsa, Raj Ekshma? Because Raj Ekshma dhatugat avastha is there, so.
The bull of the patient get reduced in.
So,
Astikshay is there, dhatukshay, okay.
Hello. Madam, hello.
Yes, sir.
First question, I think in especially in pediatrics, they never they can't express the complaints. So how will you understand? This is what a question. Am I right?
Yes. I will just unmute the doctor so he will ask. Dr. Surya Narayan, sir.
Doctor, good afternoon, Siddhanta Gowda, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Namaste, sir. Please.
It is the case of 12 years boy, hyperactive, and the studying at the 7th standard. I gone through the chest X-ray. I found a number of hairy line fractures. The history, there was no playground beaten history or fallen history or anything except the mother beaten. Because he's a hyperactive guy. In that way, I hope in that way he had, I think, after giving this Shatavari and other Laksha, he has got relief from the pain and everything. But my doubt is how it is happening, even that much only beating can give the hairline fracture. I think Dhatu Dushiti, calcium Dhatu is deficiency in this case. I hope so. I doubted and questioned here.
Sir, most of about the chest, the rib fracture, I think you are telling about.
Yeah, sir.
Yeah, most of the rib fractures, what is told in classics is you ask the patient to sit in a Taila Droni, which is having the Vatahara Taila. Importance is initial days there is an inflammatory, once it reduces, the rest itself is sufficient for these things, the rib fractures. A simple plaster application, what we do is one thing. Second thing, in case there is some supplementation you have given, Shatavari and other things. Already in Patya Patya only I highlighted the nutritional status is also important for healing, because it also contributes for the healing. Nitin sir also mentioned Dhatu Kshaya, if it is there, then there is a delayed in healing. So nutritional status of the patient as well as to the Dhatu of that particular Asti, to increase that one, you have to supplement all these things. If with the rest and supplementation of all these things, we can get proper healing in that individual. Yeah, I hope. Hello.
Sure, doctor.
Yeah, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, hello? Another thing is that how do you feel the role of Tiktakshir Basti in management of fractures, sir?
Definitely, sir. Tiktakshira, that is Ashray Ashri Bhava. With the help of Ashray Ashri Bhava, Tiktakshira Basti definitely supplements and increases that Dhatu. Kshaya will be corrected with that only, sir. Ashray Ashri Bhava, Asti and Vata.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you for a very knowledgeable lecture and guidance, sir. Now I request our chairman of the session, Dr. Dudmal, sir, for his chairmanal view.
Sir, Siddhan Gowda, sir, one more doubt, sir.
Please, sir.
If a patient ignored in Collis fracture or Menetes fracture for a more than 6 months, sir, can he get the any deformity in writing or any the writer's cramps or anything will happen, sir, if he ignored?
Yes, sir. If he ignored, sir, also, there is a, some functional problem will be there for writing and other things, sir. If it is a minimal thing is there, you can correct it by physiotherapy. Like application of Murivenna Taila, what we routinely do for the patient. Okay. With application of that and the internal medication at the simultaneously and certain physiotherapy exercises, by that you can regain that particular thing if it is not much displaced. If it is displaced and you can't attain that one proper functioning thing, sir. Because we see most of the elder females, in spite of this Collis fracture also, they lead a normal life. With some restricted movements.
Okay.
There is a mal union maybe there, or
yes, definitely.
If it is not affecting the, it will not affect the deformity, but there may be difficulty in some cases.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Really, very interesting topic is that, and all delegates or all the participants, they are having a clinical view. That's why they are asking the questions.
Yeah, no problem.
This
is
really
no
good.
Yeah, sir. One question is there good, from my side.
Please, madam. Yes,
sir. Bandhan ke baare mein kuch bataiye na for fracture. How we go with Ayurvedic? Is there any some indications about the bandhana, patta bandhana?
Definitely, madam. Individual type of the fracture will go for the different types of bandhana. For example, if you go for this, what we call it is a sling bandage, what we can call. The same thing is explained in our classics also, the same thing.
Yes.
Even in case of different types of the forearm bandages also, we do mandala and other things. That is only thing to help the to retain that particular splint, what we can call as a kusha in a particular place. To retain it and help to enhance and immobilizing purposes, we are going for those bandhana. This is what it is, one of the important, that's what Anchana, Pidana, Sankshepana, Bandhana. These four golden principles or rules are very important in the management of fracture. The last fourth one is Bandhana only. If you are not doing it properly, I have shown in one of the slide that Sushruta was very keen enough that the Bandhana should not be too loose, too tight. It should be a Madhyama or medium one so that it can prevent the blisters if you tight it to too tight. If you keep it too loose, definitely the reduced fracture will be disturbed and again go for the malunion. This is what the highlight given by Sushruta in case in the concept of bandhana. For the same reason, he has given one chapter, he has allocated one chapter in Sutrasthana regarding the bandhana, madam, in the context of Rona and other things.
But instead of plaster, shall we go for the such type of bandhana? Do you have any experience regarding this, sir? Any fracture?
Definitely, madam. The present problem what we face is there is an advanced technology and the patient also, they want the newer techniques and they should accept it. It is an acceptable form. What our bandhana principle says and Sushruta says, it should be a neat, nice and acceptable to the patient. So in that regard, present day, we get a lot of advanced technology with different colors, lighter one. In that regard, they are going for all those things. But whatever our classics has been explained, they are also excellent and effective with the same present trend. Because of this acceptability, we go for a previous present day trend available plasters.
Yes, sir. Our acharyas had mentioned the principles and nowadays they are also form, only we have to change the form we are using.
Yes, sir.
And
thank you, sir.
Shilpa ma'am.
Yes.
This is Dr. Vandana Pathak here.
Yeah, madam, please.
Sir, abhi bhi jo operations wagera hote hain where they put a thing inside or they are using plates for appositions, paper. Uh-huh. External lapens are very much helpful in healing of the fracture wounds. And I have also used many labans for healing where there is the operated case and they do not put any like madam was saying ki abhi hum upar se wo na lagaye plaster of paris aur sealing pane to the operated cases in those cases also the labs are very much along with the systemic bhagna chikitsa medications. There is one question from you, sir. Like you have been working on musculoskeletal.
Madam, it is not audible clearly. Please, can you correct some network issues or?
No, it is not a network issue.
Now it is okay. Please.
Sir, you have been working on tissues also. Like whenever there is a fracture, there is tissue damage also.
Yeah,
I think these Parishets and the medications which you have taken out from the chapter number 7 in Sushrut. These must be also helpful in tissue repairs. वो चाहे कहीं के भी हो, चाहे वो संधि तो मतलब माने तो पूरी बड़ी संधि की है. तो जैसे अभी today itself in my OPD a patient came who had a fall from 5 feet and there was nothing. कोई उस पर ब्रेन का कुछ नहीं आया, बट उसको एक अंदर ब्लॉसोफेरेंजियल पैरालिसिस ऐसे करके उन्होंने डायग्नोस किया. पर मुझे लगा कि उस समय उनका उसका वाट इंक्रीज हुआ होगा, दान क्षेत्र में प्रॉब्लम हुआ उसको एंड ही कैन नॉट ग्लूटेनेट कुछ भी चीज वो सटक नहीं सकता एंड ही इज टेकिंग ऑल द मेडिकेशंस विद द दो इट इज पार्ट ऑफ द ईएनटी बट सिंस यू आर वर्किंग ऑन द टिश्यूज all these parishakes of the sheer laksha bala your dugdh and your parishakes your madhu yashti can it be used there also because the much of things cannot be done to upar se parishek agar karte hain to kya can we help the patient where there is a damage after fall
yes
in the neck region
yes madam routinely being a surgeon we get a lot of wound cases also here if it is in contaminated wounds we go for this trifala and like tankana basma parisheka what we go for routinely the same thing here also there is a fresh wound if it is a complete compound fracture is there we will not go for immediately there madam because we need to evaluate the thing and we will not go for lap and other things if it is abrasion like other things we will go for
tissue repair soft tissue injury have you used these parishakes
parishake is very effective madam already I mentioned it instead of going for other analgesic and other things it is an excellent one which we are using routinely without giving any analgesic anti inflammatory drugs this parishake
okay thank you sir
by changing the different contents of the parishek that is kashay
thank you
okay thank you madam and thank you sir now we are almost come to the conclusion and the time is also over for the session
yes,
so sir. With the with this I request our chairman Dr. Dudmal sir for his chairmanal view
thank you sir congratulations to Dr. Siddhen Goda for nice and scientific presentation sir you have included all the basic or principles of the fracture and its management starting from the etiology symptoms and then management and yes at the same time you have highlighted the research updates particularly in the bone healing in animal model that is a very good initiative particularly as far as the Ayurveda institute is concerned because whenever there is a search regarding to the Ayurveda medications and Ayurveda formulations particularly in the bone healing that will definitely helpful for further researches first thing and nowadays western countries are also looking towards us for the sports medicine particularly I would like to brief the asthma unit in our institute there is a asthma unit I would like to highlight A for asthi, S for sandhi, M for marma, and A for abhigata. So asthi it is related to the fracture of the bones, sandhi in the sense dislocation and some joint disorders, and marma therapy. I think Dr. Naveen Joshi sir we are doing very well job, particularly in the Marma therapy. And in my institute also, I started this therapy, giving one topic to my PhD scholar. And Abhiga, that is, it is mostly related to the sports medicine. As Madam rightly said, we simply put the parishek, and if it is relieving, yes. It is having so many formulations that give the instant reliefs, particularly in the sprain or strain. And that should be encouraged. So all these four, that is asthma, it need to have the highlighted with the more and more researches. Then and then they will be recognized at the international level. Yes, in most of the institute we are doing the researches, but they are not going to highlight it. And that is a need to create the evidences. If you create the evidences, then definitely we have the upper hand, particularly in the musculoskeletal disorders. So this lecture is a very fundamental and basic lecture. I definitely think it is useful to most of the participants, and definitely they encourage for further researches in that topic. And lastly, I would like to thank organizer Dr. Naveen Joshi sir, Professor Nitin sir, and Dr. Silpa ma'am for very informative and scientific session. And thank you all.
Once again, thank you, sir, for this opportunity. And I thank Dudmal sir, Nitin sir, and Shilpa madam, and other teachers like Surinarayan sir, and all the audience for encouraging and an opportunity. And also Dr. Hemant sir, thank you one and all.
Yes, sir. It is the need of the time to discuss this type of topic.
You, I think. Now I request Dr. Shilpa Arame, madam.
Yes, thank you very much, all the speakers. Dr. Varsha ma'am, nicely explained your topic. It is really interesting. Dr. Patil sir, on time you have prepared and delivered a very nice talk, sir. It was really helpful for all the Vaidyas who are watching this platform on the Facebook also. Thank you, Dr. Dudmal sir, for your kind words. Thank you, Dr. Dhanokar sir, for moderating the session. And thank you all the doctors, all the Vaidyas who are watching the show and participated enthusiastically. So thank you very much all. This is our fifth session. On Wednesday, there is a sixth session, which is based on Agatantra, Jara. Agatantra based lecture is there. It's also helpful. And it is also interesting. The speakers are very well-known speakers. So I invite you all on that session also on that day also, 13th October, 2 p.m. same time. So thank you very much all. So namaskar sabhi ko. So I am ending the session. Thank you.
Namaskar.